has been an awakening.
You believe this?
Have you felt it?
David, haven't you been watching? David!
First teaser for Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens, has received over 91 million views in the 10 months it's been on YouTube. The second trailer was unveiled at the Star Wars Celebration Convention in April 2015. Long before we saw it in theaters, we watched the trailer from the comfort of our own laptop or awkwardly crying over the footage on our cell phone at work. Oh man, I'm not crying. I just got some Star Wars in my eye. While the Star Wars marketing machine is clearly fully operational, there's been a surprising amount of restraint shown, even as the December release date draws near. Now, you may scoff at this and point out the ridiculous 18-hour live-streaming global toy unboxing event ending with the Force Friday midnight merchandise release, or any of the 20 novel and comic book tie-ins being released under the
Journey to Star Wars, The Force Awakens
banner. But to put all that into perspective, I'd like us to take a look back and recap the insanity that led up to the release of Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. We'll jump right in and compare what many will point to as the beginning of the current Star Wars anticipation, the trailers. It's worth noting that this is not at a convention or a release event. This is at a regular movie theater before a showing of the film Meet Joe Black. Oh, I'm sorry, did I ruin that for you? Were you still hoping to get around to seeing Meet Joe Black? What madness would drive thousands to Brad Pitt's worst movie since Cool World just to see the trailer before it?
The other part of it is in order to write that first script, I had to write a backstory about where Darth Vader came from, how the kids evolved, you know, his wife, how Ben related to all that, how the Emperor came to power, and that ended up being the basis for the projects that I'm working on now.
Hype for Episode 1 begins cruelly early. George Lucas has a writer from Variety magazine over to Skywalker Ranch to announce that he is going to produce 3 Star Wars prequels. This is in October 1993, aka 6 years before the movie is released.
Today is my first day of writing the new Star Wars series.
A year later, in November 1994, Lucas begins writing the first prequel. It's still almost 3 years before shooting begins, but he has the process filmed and released on the web to further generate excitement.
I'm all set. All I need is an idea.
Fans have been stewing in anticipation for 4 years when, in August 1998, the release date is announced, May 21st, 1999. That's 281 days away for those keeping count, and believe me, people were.
Well, for all of you sci-fi lovers, this spring will be a very exciting time.
Sure will be. The new Star Wars movie will be released, taking you back to the beginning of the saga. Byron Brown launches us into the excitement surrounding Episode 1, The Phantom Menace.
3 months later, the teaser poster drops. Already, people are anticipating Episode 1 being one of the biggest releases in history. From now on, it is extensively covered by the media. Time magazine reported that every magazine but the New England Journal of Medicine has had The Phantom Menace on its cover.
Well, some folks are calling it the most anticipated motion picture of all time, if You probably know what I'm talking about. Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace.
AB's second sneak preview of the upcoming Star Wars film, The Phantom Menace, will be seen in theaters on Thursday. And you will be able to see that trailer in its entirety later on CNN.
It doesn't open till next spring, but fans are already lining up for a sneak peek at the brand new Star Wars prequel. Joel Siegel is here to tell us what people are seeing.
You are going to see the trailer, 2 minutes of Episode 1. Ooh.
November 17th, 1998, the first trailer appears in theaters. This is what fans have been waiting almost 5 years for after that initial announcement. Actual moving picture footage of a new Star Wars film. The first in over 16 years. The first trailer appeared at the beginning of Waterboy, Meet Joe Black, and The Siege. Ticket sales for these three movies skyrocket. One theater reports that sales for The Siege go up by $12,000 in one day once the trailer is attached.
There have been kids, literally thousands of kids. It's played in like 30 or 40 theaters today. It opens in thousands of theaters. Kids who would travel 100 miles, spend $6.50, $7, $8 just to see the two-minute trailer leave before the movie starts.
The trailer is released online. Think about this for a second. A week later on StarWars.net. Lucasfilm servers are promptly overloaded as they receive 400 hits a second. It is downloaded 10 million times, setting an internet record. This is especially impressive considering less than a third of Americans are online at this point. And those that are mostly had eye-gougingly slow 56K connections, meaning that downloading the 2-minute, 11-second trailer could take hours. January 4th, 1999, Ain't It Cool News posts the opening crawl from the start of the movie. This is where we start to see the fledgling internet really start to take shape, as people flock to the Force.net and it becomes a haven for hype and speculation.
The galaxy's most legendary heroes, fearsome villains, and coolest vehicles. Now available to take home and play with at Pizza Hut, KFC, and Taco Bell. Right now, at participating...
The Episode 1 marketing plan is now the ultimate power in the universe. But at what cost to Lucasfilm? What did the studio pay to cause the inexplicably named Phantom Menace to become a household inexplicable name? The answer after these messages. To give you a frame of reference, the film Armageddon, which was released a year earlier, was reported to have a marketing budget of $60 million. So what was Lucasfilm's Episode 1 marketing budget? Surprisingly, only $20 million.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away,
Pepsi created an all-new CGI mascot whose sole character trait was reflecting the world's excitement over the new Star Wars. And such was the excitement that rough outlines for the scripts of these commercials leaked and were analyzed on the Force.net. How is this possible? No, I don't mean how is it possible that Pepsi would greenlight this as their mascot. Well, yeah, how the hell? But how is it possible to have this level of marketing only cost Lucasfilm $20 million? Lucasfilm smartly realized that the media and general mood of worldwide hype would sell not only the film for them, but that businesses would come to them hoping Lucasfilm would let them cash in on the Star Wars name. And since George Lucas paid for the film entirely out of pocket, let them cash in he did. So, Marflump, the Pepsi product-loving Star Wars alien, was a result of a multi-year deal PepsiCo made with Lucasfilm valued at $2 billion. That's over 17 times the cost of the film itself. Cinematic commercials featuring Colonel Sanders, the Taco Bell dog, and the Pizza Hut lady fighting Star Wars battles show up on TV. The restaurants hold a $50 million Defeat the Dark Side contest. KFCs are themed after Naboo, Pizza Hut stands in as the Republic's capital, Coruscant, and Taco Bell is wisely chosen to represent Tatooine. Well, if there's a bright center to the universe, you're in the restaurant that it's farthest from. To enter the contest, you have to have game pieces from all three restaurants. Pepsi produces 8 billion cans of soda featuring characters and bios on cans of their different sodas. There are now more characters on cans of Pepsi than there are people on the planet. That's planet Earth for people who are getting lost on the whole KFC Taco Bell thing. Many spend months purchasing hundreds of cans of soda to complete the 24-can set. I'm sure lots of people did it, and it's really not that dumb because... Alright, I did it. And it was dumb because 10 years later I just threw them in the recycle. March 11th, the second trailer hits. Hard. This trailer is all new footage, and sends a bigger shockwave across the internet. 3.5 million downloads in the first 5 days. The trailer is posted online as a QuickTime video. This cemented QuickTime as Apple's choice of digital video format. QuickTime itself is downloaded 600,000 times the day the trailer hits the web. Steve Jobs describes it as the biggest internet download event in history. To discourage ticket scalping, Fox announces that advance tickets will not be sold until May 14th, just 5 days before the release. People will just have to wait in line and get their tickets then, like normal human beings.
I am the greatest Dark Lord of all time.
Oh wait, never mind.
When you watch Star Wars and when Luke Skywalker looks at into the sunset, you want to be in his place, you know? This is the movie event of the decade. That's why we're here, all of us.
April 7th, Fox demands that Episode 1 be shown only in each theater's largest auditorium for the first 3 months, with no non-movie ads before the film. Theaters who fail to comply lose their right to screen the film at all. Fox also limited the trailers before the movie to 8 minutes, 2.5 of which are reserved for Fox to fill with trailers for their own films. Rival studios trim down their trailers to better their chance of being shown in the remaining 5.5 minutes. April 21st, the novelization is released. This means that thousands of people know the whole story a month before they see the film, but hey, we sold the book, great job everybody. As of midnight May 3rd, toy retailers are allowed to sell Phantom Menace toys in the US. Any retailer that breaks this rule will lose their right to sell Star Wars toys forever. Toys R Us and FAO Schwarz hold their first ever midnight opening, which fans queue up for all day.
Listen, the explosive words and sounds of the Star Wars Comtech system. Imagine yourself in the movie.
I sense a disturbance in the Force.
Hasbro reportedly paid $400 million for the rights to make toys based on the movie, and they weren't even exclusive rights. There were 73 other official Star Wars licenses, some geared towards adults, such as the Queen Amidala makeup line produced by... I have no idea how to say this, but here, this company. Lego, who at this point was on the verge of bankruptcy, entered the first ever licensing deal in their 50-year history. The Star Wars series saved the company and helped make it the world's most profitable toy maker it is today.
The new Lego Star Wars Episode 1 collection, each set sold separately.
On May 4th, John Williams' score is released. Already, the track Duel of the Fates had become the first classical piece of music on MTV's video rotation and was released as sort of a single. On May 5th, George Lucas moves the release date up 2 days early to May 19th. Oh, that'll be nice, say fans who have already been camped out for a month because Fox won't allow advanced ticket sales.
It's exciting. I'm going to be going to the first show of, like, Phantom Menace. I don't know, that's all I can say. Thanks.
May 19, 1999, the film finally screens in the US. Challenger, Gray, and Christmas, a Chicago-based work issues consulting firm, estimate that 2.2 million people call in sick to go see the film, costing the US economy approximately $293 million. So, there you have it. I personally feel that the more subtle marketing behind the newest film is actually in response to the overbearing presence of Episode 1 for years before its release. Maybe the prequel trilogy didn't turn out that great. It didn't turn out that great. But I don't feel conned in any way. The world got very excited for something that was very exciting. Personally, I'm thrilled to see that Episode 7 is stripping people of the armor that comes along with letting your inner child throw themselves unreservedly at a fantasy that ultimately disappoints. People deserve to be reduced to 8-year-old awe, and actual 8-year-olds deserve to be reduced to pure wonderment. With every new image released, a voice in our head politely asks, please don't f*** this up. In the months leading up to its release, no matter how the film turns out, we can all just choose to enjoy our pilgrimage back to the Star Wars universe. Because we all know, half the
journey to Star Wars, The Force Awakens,
is getting there.